So as promised, we are going to solve more problems based on FSM. So this problem that we are having right now in front of us is nothing but we need to design a FSM to check its divisibility by 4. So we are considering the inputs to be decimal numbers. So we know that whenever we are talking about decimal numbers, the inputs would be from 0 to 9. Okay. So the step 1 remains exactly same. We are discussing about finite state machines only. So the theory regarding the machine will remain exactly same. So you need to write about what exactly a finite state machine is all about and what is its model. Okay, so let's focus upon step number 2. Step number 2 is also quite similar. The only changes over here are in terms of the number of states. As inputs are going to remain the same because we are talking about decimal numbers only. The outputs are also going to remain the same because it would be either completely divisible or not. That is, either the output will be a Y, that is yes, or N, that is no. Similarly, the states over here will be QS, Q0, Q1, Q2, with Q3 being the additional state. Why so? Because as we are dividing a decimal number by 4, so we can have remainders in the order 0, 1, 2 or 3. As we cannot have a remainder 4 because we are dividing by 4 itself, so these are the 4 states along with the initial state QS. Correct? So this corresponds to these many states. Right? So based upon this logic, let's move ahead. Our step number 3 is all about implementation, as we know. The only difference over here is in terms of this additional state Q3. Everything else remains quite similar. And along with that, we can see that there is one more column of input, which is 3. So let's have a look at what are these inputs all about. As we know that inputs are nothing but the remainders. So for example, this 0 input corresponds to all the numbers which when divided by 4 gives me a remainder 0. That is the number 0, 4 and 8. These are the numbers which when divided by 4 will give me a remainder 0. Similarly, the numbers 1, 5 and 9, which when divided by 4 will give me a remainder 1. Similarly, numbers 2 and 6, which when divided by 4 will give me remainder 2. Likewise, 3, 7 will give remainder 3. So based upon this logic, we have to design our table. So how to design our table? Let's talk about QS first. As QS is our initial state, whatever is the input that it receives, it corresponds to that particular state itself. So for example, in QS, if we receive an input 1, it will straight away go to the state which corresponds to 1, that is Q1. Similarly, whenever it receives input 3, it straight away moves to the state which corresponds to remainder 3, which is Q3 over here. Likewise, we are going to do the same thing for Q0 as well, because initially Q0 means the state is having remainder 0. So it's nearly equivalent to this only. Later on we will see in the future problems that we need to minimize our number of states by combining QS and Q0. At this point of time, let's not discuss about how to minimize it. We are going to learn it whenever we are going to face some problems based on minimization. So for the time being, let's assume these two states separately. Next is Q1. So whenever the machine is in Q1, it's assumed that it is already having remainder as 1. So whatever be the input, it simply gets appended to that particular 1, which is remainder. So if I'm having input such as 0 or 4 or 8, what happens is that 0 or that 4 or that 8 simply gets appended to the 1 which is already present in that state Q1. So as a result, if I take a mod of these 3 values by 4, what am I supposed to get? I will get answer as 2. Because if I take a mod of 10, if I take a mod of 14 or 18 by 4, I get the remainder as 2. Because 4 4s are 16 with remainder 2. 4 3s are 12 with remainder 2. 4 2s are 8 with remainder 2. So, which is the state corresponding to remainder 2? Yes, you got it right. Q2 is the state which corresponds to remainder 2. So, Q1 for input 0, 4 and 8 will straight away go to Q2. And with the same logic, if the machine is in Q2 and if I get input as 6 or 2, it simply means there is already 1, 2 over here, and if the input is 2 or if the input is 6, if I take a mod of these two values by 4, what am I supposed to get? Again, I will get the answer as 2. So Q2 on input 2, 6 will again end up with remainder 2. Likewise, the entire table is constructed. Am I clear? So similarly, over here you can see that there are only 4 inputs, 0, 1, 2, 3. But in practical sense, you are going to get inputs such as decimal numbers. For example, 7, 5, 4, 3. Then what you need to do is, whenever you encounter a decimal number, for example, 157, you need to check whether 157 is divisible by 4 or not. What you need to do? You need to check the inputs from this particular set. 1 is present over here, 5 is present over here, 7 is present over here. So you are going to check the entries in 1, 1 and 3 columns correspondingly, and then you will get your answer. Am I clear? So this was your step number 3. Similarly, step number 4 is all about transition diagram. It may look very intimidating, very confusing at the first instance, but trust me, it is not at all difficult. It is simply based on your previous step, that is your transition table. So if you have constructed your transition table well enough, then you are not having any issues. You should not face any issues constructing this transition diagram, because it's as simple as that. Just have a look at this diagram. It is completely based on the transition table. For example, Q0 on input 1 goes to Q1. If I want to check it, I can simply check it. Okay, Q0 on input 1, just check your transition table. Q0 on input 1 goes to Q1. So let's get back. That is what is being done over here. It's that simple. Just make sure that all the transitions are covered in this diagram. You might be having a different layout to your diagram. I might be having a different layout. It's totally understandable. There's no hard and fast rule that you have to draw it like this only. You can draw the diagram in a linear fashion, one after the other, horizontally. You can draw it in a circular fashion, whichever way you wish. Just make sure that all the transitions are covered. That's it. And to end this problem, let's move towards the last step, which is simulation. So simulation is nothing but it's like taking an example and solving it with our logic, whether it is satisfying our logic or not. So in this context, I have taken one example, 11214. So right now I know that if I take a mod of 11214, I'm going to get the answer, the remainder, whatever it is, as 2. How come? Because it's simple. 4 2s are 8. Remainder is 3. 32 is divisible by 4. But 14 is not divisible by 4. If I divide 14 by 4, I will get remainder as 2. So I know that the machine should not accept this particular piece of input. So let's check it, how it happens. Initially, the machine will start from QS. So QS on input 1, according to our transition table and diagram, goes to Q1. And as I have read this input, it will be eliminated. I am having the input left, which is 1, 2, 1, 4. So Q1 on input 1 goes to Q3, remaining is 2, 1, 4. Similarly, Q3 on input 2 goes to Q0 with the remaining input as 1, 4. Next, Q0 on input 1 goes to Q1, remaining value as 4. Finally, Q1 on input 4 goes to Q2, and all the inputs have been read, hence an epsilon over here, just to indicate that all the inputs have been read properly. So as a result, we are having the state as Q2, but suppose we were having a state as Q0 over here, then it would have been accepted. But right now, as we have ended with Q2 as the state, so that particular string will be rejected, as remainder is 2 and not 0, hence this particular string is rejected. Similarly, let me show one more example where I have taken a number as 24816, and if I go through it, I will come to know that at the end it is Q0, epsilon, hence the remainder is 0 and hence the string is accepted. So this is how you solve such a problem. It's one of the fundamental problems of FSM. I hope you got the understanding of how to solve such problems. Let's meet in the next video, where we are going to learn more about how to solve complex problems based on finite state machines. Stay tuned.